you're 29, net worth of over 60 million, something in that region. So how did the two even marry? That sort of narrative of, you know, money doesn't matter, be more human, don't really worry about social media, but then you're massively successful from the things that you say don't worry about.
Tim Kasser, who did the study, very, very clear. If you choose to live that way, if you choose to live by the Rolly and the Lambo, your chance of being happy is reduced. Yeah. And they do the study not once, not twice, not 10 times, over and over again. A 50-foot yacht doesn't actually make you happier if it's 40-foot or 60-foot. It just doesn't. What does make you happier, according to all the science, is like having a meaningful connection in your life. So if you end up sacrificing everything for the yacht, and including meaningful relationships, you will be miserable. Women and men both do this, is when you have an expectation that you can change someone, you can change your partner, you can make them better, you can stop them with this doing this habit that you hate, you end up emasculating them if it's a man.
100%.
Right? Because men, we're really simple.
Welcome to Link Up. Thank you for coming.
Thanks for inviting me. It's an honor.
I'm really surprised that you've come for the simple fact that about a week ago, I put up an Insta story. You know, the ones that you can people can ask you questions. And one of the questions was, who inspires you? Who do you like look up to? And who are you a fan of? And I'm not really a fan of anyone, but I do admire people. And you were in my top three.
Oh, wow.
And the reason for that is because, and I was telling you this before, oftentimes in our community, so when I say our community, I say like for the culture, people that may come from certain areas or come from certain ethnicities, they feel that there's only one route to success. And that's usually via the entertainment industry. So yeah, I thought one day I'll take a shot, DM you, get you on. And you were like, yeah, so here you are today.
Yeah, I remember getting the DM at super early hours of the morning, I believe. And I don't see a lot of my DMs, to be honest. So it's kind of quite coincidental and quite lucky that I saw that particular one. And I clicked on it, and then I clicked, and I thought, you know, I'm always trying to, I don't just want to be doing the BBC, right? And those kind of formats, the mainstream formats. So when I clicked on it and saw that you were with Link Up, and I've watched Link Up for a long time. I've watched, you know, I've watched Link Up and similar channels for a good 10 years. I was into rap battling a lot when I was 18 years old. I was going to all the Don't Flop events. And so Link Up has been part of my entertainment consumption since I was like probably around 18 years old. So it felt dope. It felt like an interesting place for me to get to talk and to be on this platform. And I could see that you'd, you know, this was one of your first episodes. And I like that. I like it when someone came on my show when I'd started it. And I didn't actually know why they'd come.
Yeah.
But that's the catalyst for getting more guests on. And you have to have those moments where someone comes on your show at the very start before you've really got, you know, 17 gazillion followers or whatever it is. And I thought it was an honor to be here. So thank you for having me.
No, thank you. And it's slightly weird or unusual because even though I'd say you're in my top three, top four, some of the things that you say, I wouldn't necessarily subscribe to or agree with for the simple fact that you say things, and this is me paraphrasing, so you can feel free to correct me. But you say things like, you know, money isn't that important. Like when you get to a certain level, you can feed your family in terms of like stopping the bailiffs. But once you get to a certain level, like money's not that important. And things such as, you know, we've stopped being human, so to speak, because of social media. And then you look at your history and the majority of your success, if not all of it, comes from social media, the internet. And, you know, you're 29, net worth of over 60 million, something in that region. So how did the two even marry? That sort of narrative of, you know, money doesn't matter, be more human, don't really worry about social media, but then you're massively successful from the things that you say don't worry about.
So I'll unpack that all. So the first point, let's start with the point about money. So money does matter, but to a point. And I think the point I was making in my book is about it doesn't beyond a point swing your fulfillment at all. Can you imagine a world where I became happier going from 5 million to 6 million? You can't. Can you imagine a world where I get happier going from a, 18K job to 100K job? You probably can. Mm-hmm. It's a substantial difference in the Maslowian basic fundamental needs of your life, survival, shelter, food, water. It really shifts things to a point, and this, the studies are super clear here. Once you, they have this nice graph which shows the plateau moment when you earn about £80,000 in your household, and that's when your Maslowian needs become met. And beyond that point, it doesn't, making extra millions and millions and millions doesn't swing it. However, people believe it does. So every stage up the income wealth spectrum, whether you're making 100K or a million or 5 million, when they ask them the question, how much money would you need to be happy, to be a 10 out of 10 happiness? Everybody says 3 times what they're currently on, regardless of if they're making a million or 5 million or 10 million. Billionaires who have a 50-foot yacht want a 60-foot yacht. It's the same thing. It's a delusion that there's this, I don't know, pot, this gold pot of happiness at the end of the rainbow that doesn't exist. So I say that to people because it's the truth in my life. When I was broke in Moss Side, shoplifting Chicago Town pizzas to feed myself at 18 years old, when I found that £13, I literally went into this chicken shop and I'd go in there to have the spare chicken bones, right? Because I legit was broke.
So you would see people's chicken.
I would go in these chicken shops hoping someone hadn't eaten their food. I went in this one chicken shop on, I think it was Fallowfield, and I'm putting my hands down the side of the chairs. And I swear the first pound coin was an accidental one. I found a pound coin and I'm like, they've never cleaned the back of these chairs. So I go around every single chair in that chicken shop and I found, I think it's £13.40 I found that day. I was euphoric. The day my company was worth 300 million and listed on the stock market, I was almost depressed.
No.
The £13.40 meant I could eat that week. The X tens of millions didn't mean anything. And in fact, I built it up to mean something to the point that the anti-climax, when you like put all of your hopes on a moment being marching bands and confetti, it can actually, the anticlimax can actually have the adverse effect to make you depressed. So that £13.40 day,
meant more.
Which took me from stealing Chicago Town pizzas to actually being like, yo, I can get pot noodles, I can get a loaf of bread, I can go to McDonald's. And I write in my diary, I fucked up because I went straight to McDonald's. I like do the whole thing. but that's what you do when you ain't got shit. You make really bad financial decisions. That's why gambling shops are always in the broke areas, right?
True.
And anyway, I blew all the money. But that was like the happiest day. And it was way happier than making tens of millions a couple of years later.
So you don't agree with money can help with happiness?
It, to a point, it does.
Yeah.
But then it doesn't keep going up. And I sit there with billionaires. This is part of what I do for my podcast. I sit there with all the billionaires. And once you get to a certain point where you're not worrying about bailiffs knocking on the door, feeding yourself, your kids, like a 50-foot yacht doesn't actually make you happier if it's 40-foot or 60-foot. It just doesn't. What does make you happier, according to all the science, is like having a meaningful connection in your life. So if you end up sacrificing everything for the yacht, and including meaningful relationships, you will be miserable. And like, I don't have to, it's not my opinion. We've done this experiment. It's called society. And it turns out that when people end up chasing the Lamborghini because they're insecure and they learn a lesson at a young age that the reason that their mum and dad are screaming at each other and the reason for stress and shame in their life is because we don't have money, so they end up striving for money. When they get the millions and millions, it's not happiness. Mm. You get to safety, but then beyond that point, it's like massaging your insecurity, fleeting massaging of your insecurities. Right. And for me, it was the same. But much of the reason I'm sat here is because I come from a broke household. Windows were smashed on my house. Mum and dad screaming at each other every day. Didn't have Christmases, didn't have birthdays. So, of course, I was in this all white neighborhood in Plymouth. Only black kid in my school, trying to figure out why my hair's curly. Why is our car shit? Why is our house smashed to pieces? Mm. Money must be the answer. Money will be the thing that allows me to bring a girl home for once, or to tell my friends for once in the 18 years where we actually live. Money will be the answer. So off I went into the world, pursuing money as the answer to all my problems. And then you get it and you realise you're actually just insecure.
So you think a lot of people that go after materialism, so let's say you see the big kettles, you see the cars.
Kettles?
Yeah, watches.
Oh, kettle. I didn't even know what that is. Fucking up from the ends.
You see like, the cars, the watches, everything's like designer from head to toe.
Yeah.
Do you think those people are just insecure? Because you're saying once
so it's
you...
an interesting thing. Do I think they're necessarily insecure? Not necessarily, but a lot of them are. So a lot of them are actually trying to build like reputation and social proofing, which is a thing that holds weight in reality. So in certain cultures, if you're obese, that means you're rich in Africa. Mm-hmm. If you're obese, that means you're well-fed, you come from a good family. That's one way of social signaling. So it doesn't necessarily mean that they're insecure necessarily, but it means they are signaling to the outside world a perception of wealth or value or status. And that typically comes from a place of like not feeling like you good are enough without. Mm-hmm. So that chain, that watch, that car is a way of you showing the world that you are enough. And it tends to be the case that people who are doing that have at some point in their life, probably within their culture, and this happens a lot within our culture, they've been convinced that they aren't enough by something. So every time I saw 50 Cent in that Cadillac when I was growing up watching MTV, and he looked really happy and he had all the bling, that's signaling to me that I can't possibly be enough without that car because he is apparently happier and more valuable with it. Mm-hmm. You can't convince, this is what advertising does. I mean, I worked in the advertising industry for 10 years. The whole objective of advertising is to convince you that there's something you don't have but need. Mm-hmm. And in doing so, the trade-off is I'm taking some of your self-esteem and holding it hostage. And the implicit thing I'm saying is like, I'm holding your self-esteem hostage. You give me that £1,000 for this, mm-hmm. and I'll give you your self-esteem back. You pay the ransom, and this is the crazy thing. You never get your self-esteem back. The ransom just increases. Now you've got to go from the Merc to a Lambo. And then when people get the Lambo, they need to go from a Lambo to the Aventador. And it's a never-ending, what we call hedonistic treadmill, where you'll just chase for the rest of your life.
Mm. So you'll never find happiness.
I know people. And one of the things that was really pivotal in my life was there was this car I wanted and there's this certain way I wanted to live. I met a guy, a billionaire, and he has it all, miserable. And I pulled up at his house.
Is this the Louis Vuitton guy with the Louis Vuitton room?
It is.
Yeah.
You read my book.
I've seen loads of things about you. So I just remember you.
I remember sleeping in his bedroom. And the security had to make, there was so much Louis Vuitton in the ninth spare bedroom. The security had to make a way for me to get in there. And I just slept that night in a Louis Vuitton room. Like when I say Louis Vuitton, I mean it went five bags deep and five bags up. And this was the ninth spare bedroom. This one was, and wasn't as happy as me. Wasn't as happy as my other friends that don't have anything. Mm. And this is really, I learned a really important lesson about life and expectations. Your happiness will basically equal the degree in which your expectations are being met. If and this is what Mo Gowda also taught me, who is on my podcast, if unhappiness is when your expectations of how life is meant to be going go unmet. And this explains why a kid in Africa who gets rice, I was born in Botswana, can be euphoric. But a billionaire in a Michelin star restaurant in West London, if his three Michelin star steak comes without the sprinkle of dust or whatever shit they put on it, he will be visibly pissed off and complain because his expectations of the world and how life should be going go unmet. So one of the ways that you can make sure you're happy, it's not Lamborghinis, it's just having better expectations.
And lower them? Are you saying we should lower expectations?
Reasonable, realistic ones. And this applies for relationships. If you have healthier expectations of your partner, you will have a better relationship. If you have unreasonable expectations of their perfection, mm-hmm. when you are flawed yourself, you should expect to have a really miserable relationship. They will never meet the expectation. Expectation is the curse of happiness.
What if we look at the word standards? So yeah. I believe that one should have a level of standards.
Yeah, yeah.
So when I read that tweet of yours to say, love someone or be happy with someone, as in a partner, based on who they are now and not what you think they should be, 100%. Because you'll be miserable. 100%. But then what about people? Because a lot of men will say this to me and many women that I know. You shouldn't always go for a guy that may be there yet. Go for a guy that has the potential. So then a lot of women, because we're nurturing and all the rest of it, a lot of women will then go for a guy on the basis of, you've got potential, I hope one day. No, don't bother.
Awful idea. What you've described there, think about what you've just said. I will love you if, this is conditional love. You are going to have an awful relationship if you have conditional relationships. You've basically accepted someone into your life and said, but it's conditional, fundamentally conditional, on you getting this, or you being this, or you becoming this. You're finished in your relationship. If you have conditional relationships, you have no chance of success.
I don't believe in unconditional love, though. I don't think it's a reality because, okay, I see what you're saying when it comes to that. But let's say, for example, you decide to be...
So let me ask you, what if they don't ever become that person?
No. So let's say, for example, I get with somebody.
Yeah.
And there's certain things that I have due to societal constraints. So I hope that you're faithful. I hope that you are open with me. Mm. I hope that, okay, those are conditions. The moment... I take it you're with a partner at the moment. You've got a girlfriend. If your girlfriend shags someone else tomorrow, you might leave her because that's the condition of to be faithful. Would you stay with her?
No, it's very different. So you've said in that situation that you have reasonable expectations of the relationship. One of them is don't fuck anybody else. I think that's a perfectly reasonable expectation.
It's a condition,
of
though.
Relationship. It's the conditional element comes in when you say, if you become, I'm loving you on the basis that you will be something. You will change who you are and become something. Mm-hmm. That's setting conditions on your love. Having reasonable expectations that you won't beat me, you won't cheat on someone, I think that's perfectly fine. And even in that situation, if that goes unmet, what happens? You're unhappy. But those are reasonable expectations to have. But if you say, I will love him as long as he always comes home at 9 p.m, he's never late, he becomes a multimillionaire, he gets a Lamborghini, not only is your relationship entirely conditional, but your expectations are unrealistic. So you're going to be unhappy and you're never actually going to be able to love that person for who they actually are now. You're never going to be able to get to a point of acceptance. It's always going to be this frustrating battle of change. And the worst thing that happens in relationships, women and men both do this, is when you have an expectation that you can change someone, you can change your partner, you can make them better, you can stop them with this doing this habit that you hate, you end up emasculating them if it's a man.
100%.
Right? Mm-hmm. Because men, we're really simple. We just want to fucking please our woman. Right? Very, very simple creatures. We want to make you happy. And every time you tell me or give me the impression that you're not happy with this or this, you're actually telling me that I'm not good enough. And it hurts so much when your girl gives you the subtle impression that you're not good enough. Mm. And it can be the tiniest thing. It can be the tiniest thing. You know, she might be vegan. You might be a meat eater. You order something on the menu. She goes, by the way, babe, you know, there's bacon in that.
Yeah, subtle, just highlighting you
you're wrong. You're not enough. I don't accept you. Mm-hmm. It's destroying. Mm-hmm. It's irreversibly destroying.
Okay,
for both sexes.
So let's take it back, because now we've established that you're saying that, okay, money's important, but it shouldn't be the focal point.
If you want to be really happy, it's not going to scale your happiness. Your bank balance won't scale with your happiness. Not my opinion. You don't need my opinion on this. It's very, very clear.
Okay, so you've just said that happiness isn't necessarily connected to money. But from a very early age, you said, I'm going to be a millionaire.
Yeah.
Why did you, is that because of the deprivation that you came from or because you didn't have a good background?
Because I experienced so much shame growing up. Like I was pretty much in an all white school other than my brothers and sisters, about 1500 kids. And our car was just smashed to pieces. It would make that sound when we pulled up at the school. So I was telling my dad to always drop me far from the school because there was less kids. No Christmases, no birthdays. My house was in an all-white, perfect middle-class area. But our house was like 6-foot grass out front, smashed window in the front of the house. It was like a hoarder's house inside. It was awful. Out the back, same. Half the house was knocked down because we went to build a conservatory, couldn't afford it. So just knocked the house down, kept it that way 15 years. Growing up, like, we all establish the value of something based on the context in which we see it. Mm-hmm. So a Nokia phone is unbelievable until you put an iPhone next to it. Mm-hmm. That's what happened to all of us. We were all like loving our snake
and
our polyphonic ringtones and crazy frog and shit. And then iPhone comes out and we're like, oh, imagine the same thing. It hasn't changed. Hasn't changed at all. But suddenly now we feel shame to have a Nokia phone. Hasn't changed. It's just the context in which we see it.
Yeah.
And that was what I was growing up. I was the Nokia.
That's what drove you.
I was the Nokia around a bunch of iPhones. And I thought, as we tend to, and as tends to be the case, the thing that invalidates us when we're younger becomes the thing we seek validation from when we're adults. And so I was invalidated by not fitting in, not having money, not having status. Mm-hmm. So I thought that'll be the thing that makes me really, really happy. And to be honest, like, it's funny because I was never unhappy. But I thought there was a lot of shame and a lot of insecurity. But I thought that money and stuff would like scale my happiness. It didn't. I was always the same. I was always Steve. I was fine.
Do you not find, though, that when you started to make... When did you make your first million?
maybe about 22 years old, 23. No, 20, on paper, 22 years old. My bank account, maybe 23, 24.
So you made your first million in your early 20s.
Yeah.
Did you not find that your quality of life improved and the people, and I know people say, okay, if people want to be around you because of your money, then it's the wrong type of attention.
Yeah.
But the reality is, especially in this day and age, we live in a superficial world, and you are more attractive, whether that's for business relationships, girls.
I see or, what happened.
Exactly, the type of girls you get. Let's not play games. Yeah. The type of girls you can get can improve.
100%.
And so didn't your quality of life improve? Even though you're saying, oh, I wasn't happier.
Is that quality of life, though? Is that getting people that want you because you've got five bottles of Dom Perignon at the table, is that quality of life? Is that really quality of life?
I attach it to something, yeah. The reason why I say that is because if I decide I want a successful person...
Sounds like an empty life to me.
No, let me explain. If I say I want a successful person, it's not because I want his money, but usually how he became successful, he has personality traits that are attractive. And I think women sense that.
Yeah.
So a person, especially as young as yourself, who's managed to make millions or who's really successful, ambitious, the way you articulate yourself, there's certain personality traits that women like.
100%.
Leader, alpha male, all the rest of it. So women are often criticized and called like, oh, she's a gold digger. Well, no, we just want a man to...
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So it's not an empty life because, no, I'm sorry. I'm not going to feel sorry for saying I wouldn't want to be with a guy who's 35 who is on the dole.
I hear, but from my perspective, do I want to, like, I completely get that. And actually, I don't have a problem with that. So what you're saying is true. Did I have more female interest when I became more successful? Yeah, partly because of what you have. But then even as a man, you walk different. You have a different demeanor. You stand different. And these are all things people don't talk about. There's a level of confidence which comes with accomplishment, which actually makes you...
More attractive.
It's really clear in the science. It goes back to our ancestral days, back 10,000 years ago when we're cavemen. The pack leader would basically have most of the sex with the females because the pack leader is the one who is most reproductively successful, has the most resources to provide for your young. So it's hardwired into us. I went through a phase of like looking at pickup artistry. So I learned a lot about our prehistoric attraction and what makes a man attracted to a woman. However, from my perspective, I don't want someone who is attracted to the bag, obviously.
But you just confirmed what I said before. It's not necessarily about the bag.
I've got no problem with that. I'm just saying, I don't want to have, you know, it's funny, like Donald Trump, I heard this story from one of my guests. Melania Trump, Donald Trump's wife, said she was asked, would you be with Donald Trump if you didn't have all the money? And she went, would he be with me if I didn't have this great body? And that's the kind of like surface level, vacuous, shallow relationship I've never wanted in my life. So I've actually had to put in more work to make sure that the person I'm with isn't there for that.
Okay.
And I've done a good job of that, I've got to be honest.
That's nice.
I genuinely couldn't buy my girlfriend a Louis Vuitton bag. If I bought her a Rolex, a fancy jewelry, a Cartier, a Louis Vuitton bag, she would be genuinely disgusted. I know you're smiling, you're like, fucking, I'll have it. I can see in your face, you're like, woo! No, genuinely, I have to get her fucking incense and a cuddly toy and like sentimental shit. I have to make a scrapbook.
No, sentimental stuff is important.
Designer anything from me.
Yeah.
Never. If we stay at really nice hotels, babe, can we stay at the hut down the road?
And you really like that because it means that she's there for you.
Good values.
Yeah.
There's an absence of good values. We live in a culture of junk values. Mm-hmm. And I know what happens when you live by junk values. Again, the science is really clear. They've done it with children. They've done it with teenagers. If you live by junk values, your chance of despair is higher. Your chance of depression is higher. Your chance of anxiety is higher. Your chance of meaningful connections is lower. They get these kids and they do this incredible experiment where they put this like toy on this television with these group of kids and they advertise this toy to a certain group of kids and then they give it to a really nasty human being. And the kids, after seeing the advert, will go and play with the really nasty human being. They'll go and choose to connect with the really nasty human being who has the shiny toy. Think about that like the Lambo, right? They then get another group of kids, they don't show them the advert and they say, who do you want to play with? None of them want to play with the nasty person. Because, and what's happening there is the advert and the conditioning of the TV, in our case, Instagram, Lamborghinis, the Rolly, all of that stuff, is making them sacrifice the chance of a meaningful, good relationship and good values just so they can play with a toy. But in exchange, they have to deal with someone who is like toxic, bad values. And yeah, there was a professor called Professor Tim Kesser who did the study. Mm-hmm. Very, very clear. If you choose to live that way, if you choose to live by the Rolly and the Lambo, your chance of being happy is reduced. Yeah. And they do the study not once, not twice, not 10 times, over and over again. Mm-hmm. We live in a society of junk values where everybody's choosing the Lamborghini and the Rolly over happiness, and they don't even know. Pleasure and happiness are two entirely different things. Yeah, Our generation have no idea, because there's no one in our generation that's saying it. It just doesn't get likes. It doesn't get any likes. No one's going to double tap and do the flame emoji in the DMs. There's nothing for it. So it doesn't travel. And we all live by the Rolly. And look what happens. Depression's on the rise. Anxiety's on the rise. Mm-hmm. Like crazy. This generation, anyone that uses Instagram has a significantly higher chance of depression. Why?
Junkvalues.com. I totally agree, because I know a lot of people that live by that sort of, I want the next...
Almost everybody.
Yeah, exactly. But then I remember one of my first jobs was in Barrett's shoe shop years ago. And there was a lady there and she had two pairs of shoes. One pair of shoes for work and one heels. And sorry, one pair of trainers. And every year without fail, her and her husband went to Pontins in Spain twice a year. And they had a car that was like an old car. They had the same car for like over 10 years. And she said, I'm really, really happy. And I even said to her at the time, why don't you like switch up a bit? Like, why don't you go to a different... She was like, why? We have so much fun going to Pontins and going to Spain all the time.
Look at her expectations of life.
So happy. Her husband and they do simple things in life. But then the people that you were saying, by the Rolly, by the... They're never, ever content.
Never.
But... The thing about that is,
here we go.
If you're content, I feel that stifles ambition. So if we go back to your original story of when you decided, I'm going to start a business from my bedroom in Manchester, to then when you left Social Chain, it being worth 300 million, how did you get there with just thinking money's not going to be my main motivator?
Mm. This is a really good question, because it's one of the questions that I puzzled over until the 20th and last chapter of my book, because I'd gone through my book and realized that that striving was important in life. And in fact, when you look at what makes people happy, striving for something really, really matters. So having a worthwhile goal that's slightly, just before your zone of competency, so it does challenge you, striving towards that really does make people happy. The minute they lose that, we're talking Olympians when they come back from the Olympic Games. Boxers like Tyson Fury when they win the world title. What happens is they lose orientation, they fall into depression. Mm-hmm. So striving is really important. Ambition is really important. So I was trying to contest with this idea of how do you know that you are enough and you already have everything you need whilst also being ambitious at the same time. And then I kind of realized in the last chapter of my book that in fact, the words were wrong. Enough implies that if I were to achieve my ambition, if I were to achieve X, Y, and Z, I actually become internally more and less. Like the value of Steve Bartlett could fluctuate. Mm-hmm. And that's just a bad use of words. I will never, regardless of how much money I make or the car I've got outside, actually be worth more. I'll never be more or less. And once you get rid of that and you realize that once you rid yourself of your insecurities and this idea that you can become more, you can be worth more internally, the foundation that's left for me was one of like real ambition. Once you say, fuck it, I'm not going to listen to social media or the external world. What does Steve Bartlett actually want and care about? So in fact, knowing you're enough and that you'll never be more is the foundation for striving for things, because you actually want them. It's the foundation of real ambition. All that other shit is fake ambition. That's pleasing others and clout and all that stuff. Knowing you're enough means that you go, fuck it, what do I actually want in life? Mm-hmm. I don't need a Lamborghini, I don't need that house, I don't need that yacht. That was all for other people. So knowing you're enough, actually being secure in yourself, makes you go, do you know what? I really want to just go and dance in fucking the hills in Peru. And I really just want to be a painter. I don't want a Lamborghini. That was my insecurity and my thoughts that I could someday be more. I just want to be a poet.
But you, the good thing is that you understand where that feeling comes from, because like you said, but I think were you 14 or 15 and you said, I want a Range Rover Sport. So you you understand.
18, read it in my diary.
18, yeah? So it's not something that you completely are disconnected from as to why people want those things. And the interesting thing about you is when I spoke to someone and I said, you know what, I think I'm going to have a sit down talk with Steven Bartlett. And he said, oh, that's not relatable. Why are you going to get that's him? So like, I like him so much, but he's like, the mandem are not going to get that. Yeah, and I'm like, why not?
I love that.
And I said, do you know what? This guy, because like your mum's Nigerian, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So you were born in Botswana, your mum's Nigerian.
Yeah, yeah.
And as we know, especially in our community, when it comes to Asian and African parents specifically, and it used to be this way with Caribbean parents, it's go to uni, go to uni, go to uni.
Yeah, yeah.
So you went to uni.
Yeah.
One lecture.
Yeah.
Then you told your mum, it's not for me. Mm. And she said, I'm never going to speak to you again.
Yes.
And that led to you having to live in a very awful flat in Moss Side.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the reason why my friend said he's not relatable is because certain man in that situation would have hit the belly. They would have done illegal things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
I did.
What, steal pizza?
No comment. I'm not going to snitch on myself.
No, but that's the thing. And it's like, whether you did illegal things or not, the point is you managed to turn things around very quickly. So how old were you when you were living in the shithole?
So there's something interesting here, because the reason why I think that people also might not find me relatable, it's something that I've always been conscious of, is I look like I'm a long way from that now. I speak different. I seem like I'm really articulate. I use really big words and stuff. And I think that can be really quite alienating to people, going, well, he doesn't sound like me, so it's a little bit too far away. People want a bit more of a bridge, a closer bridge to get in there. Mm-hmm. And all of this stuff, like my grades in school were shit. I got kicked out of school, went off to university, 18 years old, went for one lecture, dropped out straight away. I can't spell to this day. I can't do maths. I'm a fucking dragon on Dragon's Den. I can't do maths well at all. I think I got like a D or something in maths. In English, I'm really, really bad in English. But everything you see from me has been, including speaking, has been 10 years of doing it every single day. I remember the first time I spoke in front of an audience at 14 years old, and I'm holding this piece of paper, and I'm so nervous and shitting myself in front of like 20 parents in my school. The paper's shaking so much, I'm like, I can't read that, so I just have to make up the words. Mm-hmm. And then you fast forward 10 years, I'm going up on stage and Obama is sharing a stage with me in Brazil in front of 15,000 people.
Crazy.
Like, just, and this is what I always have to say, like, there's nothing about me that special. There was no smarts, I wasn't good in school, my attendance hits 30%, Mr. Thomas kicks me out of the school, I go off to university, again, last a day, move into Moss Side, parents don't talk to me, but there was the thing that definitely was a gift from God was I always believed. There was no way this wasn't how this story ended. And you see it in my diary. Like the diary I recorded in 2012, the first page of it, I tell this story. I write in the first page of my diary that I'm recording this diary because one day I'm going to have to tell the press about this story. Like that's what I wrote in the
you
first
had
page.
That, and do you know what?
I'm in Moss Side stealing Chicago Town pizzas, and I can show you it when we stop recording. I write in the first page of my, I'm recording this diary because one day I'm going to have to tell the press about how I did all of this. That's the mindset I was in. And this is why I say I was as happy as I am now in Moss Side, because there's this video of me on my little Motorola going through my house and going, look, open my fridge, nothing in it. Oh, look, all these bailiff letters on my desk. I'm like documenting it as if it was after the fact. Because I did not believe that was my life. I was like, I'm getting out of here by hook or by crook. I was working call centers through the night, started designing my business again. No idea how you'd make a website. Fuck it, I'll launch a social network, start designing it on Word. It's designing it on Word during the night shifts at late rooms in Cheatham Hill. And I just worked really hard and I always believed I'd get there.
So would you say any of it was about luck?
There's always an element of luck.
Yeah.
It's interesting. It's funny. I can show you moments where I go, oh, I got lucky there. But then you look closely and you go, well, I did send the email at 3 a.m. Mm. What was everyone else doing at 3 a.m.? That's
exactly.
What I think. That's the way I see it.
You work if really hard.
If you constantly like flip a coin, you're eventually going to get 10 heads in a row.
Yeah.
Probabilistically, you're increasing your probability of getting that like thing in hindsight that you go, oh, fuck, that was lucky. There's loads of like luck and there's loads of unlucky situations, to be honest. I mean, me starting a social media business in 2012, mm-hmm. when that wave was coming into shore, good timing.
Yeah.
Really good timing.
And this is the thing, you said you always believed in yourself from day dot. You were going to be a millionaire. That was it. And I really like what you actually say about belief, because on Instagram, as you know, you see all these quotes, and I can't stand a lot of these quotes because I'm just like, that sounds like esoteric bullshit.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can't just have this Disneyland idea of what belief is. You have to put work behind the belief for you to eventually believe that thing.
Mm.
And how? When did that moment come to you?
It was actually... I knew that like standing in front of the mirror in the morning and telling yourself you're going to be a millionaire isn't it. And I knew we got consumed by this culture which really loves simple answers to complex questions. So if I was to post on Instagram and go things like everything happens for a reason, people go, oh, brilliant, fantastic. I'll just chill then. Or just wake up in the morning, go downstairs, look in the mirror and say, I'm great, I'm going to be a millionaire, you've got this, girl. Like, it doesn't fucking work. Like, it's the equivalent of like getting in your car in the morning, setting the sat nav and just fucking sitting back. You're going to be in your garage all day.
And I absolutely love that.
You've got to drive. Mm-hmm. And this is the bit that is left out of this self-development bullshit, because it requires really, really hard work. People love simple solutions, simple, easy solutions to complex problems. This is why if I made a book, the title was Six Pack Abs in 3 Minutes, it's fucking going to sell. If I write six pack abs, but you've got to eat really healthy for 6 months and you've got to go to the gym every day for 7 months, no one's going to buy my fucking book. So to answer your question, I'd learned a couple of things about the way belief works, and I'd realized that if I tell some, we've all got that friend where we try and encourage them to change their life, mm-hmm. and we try and, you know, and it just doesn't fucking work. And maybe 5 years later, they'll do it themselves. And I wondered why that was, why my quotes, me just saying this shit wasn't working. Mm-hmm. And it's because beliefs are evidence-based. And I can prove this to you very simply. I can prove to you that you actually don't choose your beliefs. If I got your, I use this example quite a lot. If I got your, who's someone you love?
My mum.
Your mum. I get your mum. I've got her here in a headlock. I've got a gun, right? And I'm going to pull the trigger unless you believe that I am Jesus Christ.
I'm going to lie.
You're going to lie, but you couldn't believe it. Even if everything's on the line, you can't believe something you don't. That's how our beliefs work. It's the same about your belief in yourself. You can't look yourself in the mirror and go, believe in yourself, love. It doesn't work. However, if I start levitating and I get some water and I go, wine, you might start believing it just a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
You need evidence to change your beliefs. And it's the same about your belief in yourself. So if I do a little quote and I go, oh, believe in yourself on Instagram, but you've gone through 20 years of that kid on the playground saying you're a piece of shit, this person you love telling you you're a piece of shit, you have an experience and then your confidence was knocked. My words are so weak compared to all of that evidence you've built.
Mm-hmm.
So if you want to believe in yourself, you got to go get evidence.
Yeah, and it's refreshing because we live in a society where, especially on Instagram, there's like the secret affirmation, tell yourself in the morning, I'll be great.
And cozy, it's like, bullshit.
Cozy bullshit.
Yeah.
And I find it so annoying. And when I express this, the first thing people say to me is, you're so negative. And I'm like, no, I'm a realist. Yeah. There's a difference between being negative and being a realist. I know if I want to believe in myself, I have to put incremental steps in place for me to be like, oh shit, okay, I got this. Mm. I did this. Now I'm starting to believe in myself.
Amen.
And it's unusual that you would think that. And this is a question that I completely is off the cusp. But because you have that view on belief, does that mean that you don't believe in God or religion? Because no one can see God, let's be honest.
I don't believe in religion.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the verdict is kind of out on God. I don't have evidence that God doesn't exist. At the same time,
yeah.
Right? So I would class myself as kind of being agnostic and open,
mm-hmm.
but I don't believe in religion because I have a lot of evidence to say, I mean, which religion? There's 5,000 of them. Which God? There's Thor, right? And if I was born in a different part of the world, I would believe in Allah. And if I was born in where I'm from in Botswana, mm-hmm. it would be a different iteration of the God you probably believe in. And mm-hmm. I didn't believe at a very young age that religion and the keys to heaven would be given based on where I was born. That doesn't seem like it makes sense to me. I don't think it's fair that kids that are born on that side of the world are going to burn in hell, and ones that are born in that part are going to be just fine, and they're going to have, you know, like the nice white robes and stuff. I didn't believe that to be true. So, as it relates to religion and these like man-made constructs, I don't really care about that. Mm-hmm. As it relates to a higher being or like spirituality, I'm kind of agnostic.
Okay, me too.
Yeah.
That's good to know.
Okay.
So, we've spoken about beliefs and a few of your opinions, but I want to get down to the nitty-gritty of how you actually manage to make millions. And I know you say, you know, money, all the rest, but we care about money. Yeah. We want to know how to make money.
Yeah.
And I know you've said this story loads of times before, but in the shortest, simplest way, from deciding to start a business in your bedroom,
how
did it become successful? Because you yourself said you were thrown out of school, you struggle with spelling, you struggle with maths, you didn't really understand the concept of business, but today the company that you founded is worth in the region of 600 million.
Mm.
How did that happen?
Kind of like Link Up. Kind of like Link Up TV in a way.
Yeah?
Nice and early, nice and consistent. Saw an opportunity, carried on doing it because you love it. Similar to me, I dropped out of university, started this website called Wall Park.
Yeah.
And Wall Park was a student notice board. University still had physical notice boards. They still do today. So I naively walked in and thought, well, okay, there's a university here. There's actually two down the road. I was at Man Met. There's two down the road. Why do they still use physical notice boards? And people are like, look, they've put post-it notes on this fucking piece of like plywood to communicate with each other in 2012. To me, that was nuts. I thought, okay, I'll just put that online. I'll put notice boards online for universities. That was my business. When it came to trying to figure out how to get hundreds of thousands of students to come to it, I went and did flyers. Didn't work.
Mm-hmm.
Posters. Didn't work. Spent the remainder of my marketing budget on like an advert in the student newspaper.
Didn't work.
Didn't work. And then I saw this Facebook page blowing up, had like 5,000 students on it. And I reached out to the owner and I gave him 50 quid for the Facebook page. It had 5,000 Manchester students on it, posted on it.
You bought it from him?
50 quid.
For 50 quid?
Yeah, met him in Manchester Piccadilly in the middle of Manchester and bought it off him for 50 quid. He made me admin, posted my website on it, and it was the most people we'd ever had. So I thought at that point, social media is the way. The numbers are bigger here. Mm-hmm. Met a guy called Don McGregor. He had a student Twitter page called Student Problems. It now has about 12 million students on it. At the time, it had 5,000. Met him, said, drop out of university, come with me.
You told him to drop out of uni?
Yeah, yeah, he came. He was my co-founder. He's very successful now himself. And then, so we were trying to drive traffic to my website. What I ended up doing was making a Facebook group for every university in the country, all the big universities. And the group was basically a notice board. And I was like, why aren't people doing that on my website? They're doing it in the group now.
Yeah.
So I was like, what I'll do is I'll close the group and I'll pin a post saying you've got to come do it on Wall Park, right?
Drive people to your website.
They didn't come.
No.
They wanted to do it in the group. Yeah. And eventually, after 2.5 years, I just gave up the fight and thought, fuck it, close the website down. We'll just build communities on Facebook and on social media. And that's what we did. We got hundreds of millions of followers. At our peak in 2017, I remember Tubular released the rankings. We were doing 7 billion video views a month on social media, on our channels. Sporf we own, still to this day, it's got, I don't know, a lot of the guys listening to this will know Sporf. It's got maybe 60 million sports fans. Love Food was the biggest food page in the world at the time. So we had all these social media pages and that became its own business called
Was that on Instagram?
Every platform.
Oh,
we were
okay.
Actually like mega on Twitter. We had this like monopoly on Twitter to the point where back then, 2016, we would say to press, we can make anything the most talked about topic online in 30 minutes. And they would come, so the Gadget Show came to Social Chain.
Mm-hmm.
They gave us the topic within 30 minutes. It's like 12 minutes. Live on their show, it's the number one talked about topic in the country. BuzzFeed came down, they did a big piece on us. It was more of like a hit job piece. Same thing, give us a topic, we'll make it the most talked about thing in this country. And we did it within 30 minutes. So we had this huge influence back then. Because we knew social media, we started an agency called Social Chain, which went on to now does the marketing for Amazon, Uber, Coca-Cola, Logitech. Like these are 7-figure contracts with the biggest brands in the world. And then we used our expertise and our audience to start an e-commerce company, which is now actually the bigger part of the business. The business will do maybe 400 million in revenue from e-commerce mm-hmm. this year. So it's a pretty big business. It went to the stock exchange. Listed on the stock exchange, which is that day I was telling you about. And shortly after that, I quit.
Before we talk about you quitting, because I know you've got a thing about quitting.
Yeah.
How did you know that you would be able to go on the stock exchange and become public? Because I think loads of people that started off like you, that are not as big as you, they have no concept of being able to think their company can go public like that. Did you always know my company's going to go public?
No. And this is probably a good lesson is like, you as a founder, you're not actually that important. You're like sole responsibility and objective when you start a business. And this is going to be the most important thing I say, because it's the most important thing as it relates to business, is hiring people that know shit you don't know. And like, when I was young and I was 21 and I first started Social Chain, I was so wrong in thinking that I was the most important part of my business and that the knowledge I had would be the single biggest predictor of my success or failure. I was so entirely wrong. I wish I had realized earlier how much I didn't know. But you don't know what you don't know. They are unknown unknowns. And in hindsight, when you start a business, you are just a recruitment company. The thing that will decide whether you succeed, how far you go, if you ever go to the stock market, is who you manage to get to come and work for you.
Good people.
I didn't know a fucking thing about the stock market. But I went and found people that did. Mm. And I trusted those people and had those people around me. To be honest, imagine this. We end up doing the marketing for Coca-Cola across 14 countries in Europe. We end up doing the marketing for Uber across the whole of the United States. Do you think I know how to deal with an Uber in terms of marketing? I'd never done it before. How could I possibly? I went and found people that did. And like at some point in your business journey, you'll realize that when you're a founder or CEO, your only job really is finding the best people in the world that you possibly can and binding them together with a culture that brings the best out of them. Because like a football team, we used to talk about this a lot in the office, we would look at, say my CFO, my finance person is the goalkeeper. Mm-hmm. It's my goalkeeper against my competition's goalkeeper. Who have we got? Up front is our salespeople. Mm-hmm. Our competition down the road, they've got that guy, he's got 10 years experience. Who've we got in comparison? We got some kid that's done it for 6 months. We got no fucking chance. If you look at it like that, and the sooner you realize that you are, no matter what business you're in, LinkUp TV, any of my companies now, you're just a recruitment business, you'll go so fucking far.
And you managed to pull it back really quickly because, as I said, you're only 29 now.
Yeah.
Okay. So you're saying, oh, if I would have known this back then, like, you're not 29. How did you manage to so quickly? Because I think, again, you're the youngest person I've had on here. Oh. And oftentimes it's people that are a bit older that say, oh, you know, it took me years. But how did you quickly understand that concept of it's the people around me that are important that I recruit?
Well, I started my first business maybe 13 years ago. And I started my first like real business with investors 11 years ago.
Okay, so you're well oiled in.
Well, I took investment at 18 years old when I dropped out of university for Wall Park. So I've been doing this a long time. And I can connect a lot of dots in hindsight and look back and say, damn, you were stupid, Steve. You spent 2 years just hiring. Oh, you want a job? Okay, come work for me. Oh, you work at Prada. Could you put the bag down and come join my company? Like, I was just hiring anybody. And in hindsight, that day you bring in a killer, like an A1 hire, and you go, oh my God.
Changes everything.
And they're 10 times the value, but they get paid 2 times the wage of your second best hire. Mm-hmm. You go, well, what if I just went out and I just spent all of my time trying to find the best people in the world and putting them in this room. What would happen then? And then you do that. And then you go, oh my fucking God.
Yeah.
And then I got to the point where I was 27 years old, which is when I quit Social Chain. And I'm in New York City, running the office out there, 50 people there. And I realized that I could literally not come to work for 4 months and the business would still grow.
Because you had solid people around you.
They were better than me. All the managing directors around the world, running the teams, doing every single division in my company, were better than me. They'd been doing it for 10 years. So I could, at the end of Social Chain, like, I was redundant. And that's what good business is. If you can make yourself redundant, as an entrepreneur, I think you've succeeded.
And we struggle with this in our community. The reason why we struggle with it is going back to the example that you gave. When you had, growing up, when you had nothing, you desperately wanted to prove that you were worthy by having the Range Rover, by being a millionaire.
Yeah.
And I think because many people from ethnic backgrounds are at a disadvantage, now it's like they want to I don't want to say hog the glory, but 100%. Hog the glory.
100%.
They want to be the front man. They want to be 100%. The one up in lights to say, I did that. Or why? Or there's a big trust issue.
100%.
In our community, there's massive issues with trust. Like, I can't trust that person. So what advice would you give to even recruit the right people? What's the first thing you do?
Go to therapy. I think maybe the biggest... predictor of failure for a CEO or a founder in our day and age is like some shit that happened to them on the playground that made them insecure. And then they start making their decision through that lens. They then start treating people like shit. They then don't have the humility to accept feedback or to know their weaknesses or to acknowledge their weaknesses. And honestly, like most founders just need to go to therapy if they want to become a better founder or CEO, because it's their ego and insecurities getting in the way of their success. And if they really ask themselves, like, what is the objective here? The objective isn't to for me to be a CEO. The objective is I want to be rich and I want this business to be successful. So look at, in our country, the real success story businesses, especially the young ones. Look at Ben Francis at Gymshark. Stepped down as CEO when there was 30 employees. The company is now worth almost 2 billion. He was at my house last week. The company's worth 2 billion. This guy gave up CEO role when he founded the business, gave up the CEO role when there was 30 people. There's now like thousands. They got offices all over the world. And he stepped back into the role. What Ben did was go, do you know what? I'm not capable of running Gymshark because I don't know shit. So I'm going to spend the next X amount of years learning. I'm going to work in... This is what he did. He worked in every single team at Gymshark. 6 years later, he goes, I'm ready now. And they made him CEO. So he's been CEO now for 4 months. And he's doing a great job. That is the level of like humility and self-awareness and focus on the right objective that results in someone being Bren Francis, 29-year-old billionaire, Huel. I'm an investor in Huel. You probably know the brand. I'm on the board of directors there. CEO Julian steps down as CEO. Put someone in that's operationally better. Business is the fastest growing e-commerce company internationally in this country. And it's making hundreds and hundreds of millions. That level of humility, if you can put your ego aside and put your business first, you can go first, you can go really, really, really far. And in the two businesses I've started now, guess who's not CEO? Me.
Well, when do you know to quit though?
Quit what?
So you left Social Chain.
Yeah.
And when it was literally becoming massive, why did you leave then?
I've been a very peaceful quitter in my life. And it's because I've realized that in hindsight, I have a bit of a mental framework I work through, which I shared in my book, where I don't quit things because they're hard. Typically, a situation being difficult is an indicator that it's a growth moment. Mm-hmm. It's teaching me something, I'm developing. Something being hard, like a marathon, isn't evidence that you should quit for me. Something sucking, and you can define that however you want, toxic in whatever way you want it, whether that's a relationship or a job. And when you get to the point when something sucks, and the effort it would take to make it not suck isn't worth the return, then it's time to quit. So if you're in a relationship with your partner and you know it sucks, and the effort it would take, marriage counseling, therapy, all those conversations, isn't actually worth the relationship, quit. And that's what happened to me. I was in a situation where I didn't enjoy the role I was in as CEO for a number of reasons. And I knew that the amount of work it would take to make it not suck just was no longer worth the potential return. And as I said, I backed myself my whole life. So I knew I'd quit and go do something else I'd be fine.
So let's talk about now. You've got one of the best podcasts, Diary of a Podcast, of a CEO, sorry. Mm. And it's charted twice. Mm. And it makes in excess of almost 2 million a year. Mm. Is that your main breadwinner now?
No.
What's your main breadwinner?
Business.
What business?
There's two companies I founded in the last year. So Flight Story's just been announced.
Yeah.
Helps companies that are going to the stock market. Now I know a thing or two about the stock market, thankfully.
Okay.
So it helps companies that are about to IPO.
Yeah.
There's been a big change in the world and everybody's an investor now. Like I'm sure a lot of people in here are investing now. Mm-hmm. In crypto it might be, but because of the changes in apps and technology, we can all now buy Amazon stock from the palm of our hand. Mm-hmm. So what's happened in these big companies that are going to the stock market is they now want to figure out how to get you guys, normal people that we call retail investors, to bet on them. And that conversation and decision is being made on social media, mm-hmm. which is my wheelhouse. So we help these companies understand how to get retail investors to invest in them using social media. That's Flight Story. Team in London, it's flying, it's doing great. It's been going for about 2 months. It's made 6 million in revenue. It's really, really profitable business, very low headcount. It's doing a great job for its clients as well. And the other business is called Third Web, which is in the blockchain space. Our investors are Gary Vaynerchuk, Mark Cuban from Shark Tank,
oh, wow.
a lot of other big name billionaires from San Francisco. The business is predominantly based in San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And if you're trying to put NFTs, cryptocurrencies, marketplaces, packs, anything Web3 and blockchain related into your website, app, or whatever, mm-hmm. you can do it using our platform without writing a line of code. So very much like Stripe or PayPal handles the payment processing part for you, we will handle everything for you. Just plug it in without writing any code. And you own that wallet, you own that NFT drop, you own that those currencies. So it makes it stupidly easy for people to access this new thing called Web3, which is going to consume the entire world.
Cool. So let's go back to Flight Story. It's really interesting because huge companies are realizing, like you said, the value in potentially someone releasing a video on TikTok and that can determine the value of that company. They could either lose billions in value or have it increased.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to me because so many people, whether it's about relationships or whether it's about arguments online, oftentimes you hear people say, it's not reality. This morning, someone responded to me and they were really rude. They were swearing and everything. And I said, in real life, you would never just come up to me, you don't know me, and say, you chat absolute bullshit. Oh, it's not real. The internet's not real. I can do what I like. And I'm so glad that you've launched a company that makes people realize the internet is very real.
Oh, it's stupidly real.
Like, we probably spend equal amounts, if not more, online than we do, I don't know if this is a good thing, but in-person interacting.
It's stupidly real. I mean, and what we're seeing with this whole metaverse thing that Facebook have announced is the transition. I mean, Facebook have basically made the decision that their company is now going to be called, in essence, digital reality, because we're going through this transition where our digital lives, our followers, our digital friends, all of these things are becoming as worth, maybe more than our physical lives. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, it's not the conversation I'm having, but that is the reality of the situation. And I look at my phone, and if I showed you my phone now, it will tell you that I've had 13 hours a day screen time on average for the last 7 days. I know, because I...
How do you feel about that? It is what it is. This is the
way. It's not great. It's not a good thing.
But the, like I said, the majority of your success and your millions is from being online. So you can't really knock it, can you?
I don't knock it, but I can do it and also know it's bad. Like, people smoke and they know it's bad. I can like be on my screen for 13 hours a day and know it's bad. So I can say that is bad, but still.
Isn't the aim to quit though?
Sorry?
Isn't the aim to quit? When you're smoking and you know it's bad, it's like one day, hopefully this January.
Some people just do it because there's an upside for them, stress relief from smoking. For me, I know my screen time is super high. I do want to have more balance in my life because I also know the science is really, really clear that this is not a healthy way to live. So I try and do things to, you know, take myself in that direction. Meditation. Whenever I'm with my partner, she, no screens. So I've just come back from Indonesia. I was there for 8 weeks.
Oh, Indonesia is amazing. Which part did you go to?
Bali.
Yeah. Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, I loved it. Yeah. She lives out there.
Oh, okay.
So if I want to...
You just hop over to Bali.
Yeah, hop over. 8 days quarantine. Fuck me. It's 10 now. Can't hop over. Got to sit in a hotel for 10 days.
But at least you can get away and meditate and things like that.
Yeah, I go over there and it's much chiller. And she's very strict about phones and screens. So it gives me a bit more balance. And then I come back to London and it's like fucking sellotape the thing to my face like a virtual reality headset. So it's
but there's positives. Mm. But talk to me about you becoming the youngest dragon on Dragon's Den. How did that gig... How did that gig happen? You were even nervous and you don't come across as a nervous person. So talk me through that.
I was going to do a show with Channel 4 and I was about to sign the deal. I almost started work on the show and then Dragons called me and they said, don't sign. They said, don't sign that contract. Give us till Monday. We want to speak to you. And on that Monday, they sent me this big letter from someone at the high up in the BBC saying, we'll guarantee you'll be on Dragon's Den next year if you don't sign that deal. So I didn't sign it. Because Dragon's Den is, you know, it felt like an honor and a responsibility. I've been watching Dragon's Den since I was 12 years old. I've been sat there in front of the TV learning what business was from this show called Dragon's Den, looking at this person called Peter Jones and Deborah Meaden. And then for them to say, oh, you want to be on it? I applied for Dragon's Den 10 years to the week from the day that I was accepted as that I was announced as a dragon. And it's my pinned tweet on Twitter. Someone found it. That diary I was talking about that I started keeping when I was like in Moss Side. There's a video of me online and you can see my screen and the diary is open on the screen. Someone zoomed in and it's like 2013. I've applied for Dragon's Den. I think I'm going to get on it. My application's really good. Mm-hmm. 10 years later, I was announced as a dragon. So it held this like prestige in my heart. And I say responsibility because 12-year-old Steve didn't see anybody that looked like me on that show.
Yeah, exactly.
There was no black people on that show.
Yeah.
And there was no people that appeared to come from very humble beginnings. So I felt a sense of responsibility because I thought, you know, there's going to be a 12-year-old kid watching me on his rug in his front room, realizing that he can sit here too, irrespective of how curly his hair is or how the color of his skin. That's the responsibility. And then the honor is just because, yeah, I mean, that show's been around for a long time. A lot of people watch it. It's now moved to BBC One for the first time. And it's a big platform. So.
And when's it out?
January 6th. I'm only allowed to start saying that as of 2 hours ago. So.
Oh, okay.
It's January 6th. It's going to be out less than a month away.
And are you now speaking to your mum?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, we talk.
Have you been back to Botswana?
No, I haven't.
Do you have close? Because I feel even though you speak about being, you know, mixed race and, you know, you faced racism and things like that, do you feel connected to the culture?
It's such an interesting one because it's so funny, you know, and this is maybe something with being mixed race. When I was in school, I was black. Like I was the night sky. I was
to everyone
M-bomb.
Else.
I was blacker than black. And then you kind of, like, if you get into another culture, you're white. To like to a certain culture, I'm now not black enough. And this is like the issue with being in the middle.
Mixed
is,
race, yeah.
Yeah, you go through your life being blacker than black, and you go into the world and you're like, oh, you're a certain culture, oh, you're white. Mm-hmm. And you never know which group, like who, but, yeah. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's like kind of selective. I'm black when people don't want, you know, want me to be white,
yeah,
and white
yeah,
when
yeah.
people want me to be black, yeah. Right? I've always been, I mean, I used to be on some of these channels rapping when I was 15, 16,
maybe
17.
We should dig those up.
Please don't.
No, but yeah. I just, more than like being like mixed race or black or, it more about like...
You talked about culture.
Culture of Botswana, like the food. I'm not even African, I'm Caribbean. I'm mixed race, but I love Nigerian food. I like Ugandan food. Like, do you have an attachment to Botswana?
Well,
Botswana
my
culture?
Mum ran a restaurant that served African, she was our family restaurant, Caribbean and African food for my whole childhood. So I worked in there every day for about 11 years as a chef with my sister didn't work in there. My older brothers serving jollof rice, saltfish and ackee. I was in the kitchen making all kinds of shit.
Yeah.
My whole life. So if you go to my house in Shoreditch now, it's gonna see Maggie in the, like I can't eat anything without cayenne pepper in it. So I'm like my mum, we only ate to the point where we had the food in our house was so spicy that when I went into like the normal world, I was like, why don't people see?
Seasoning.
Why does no one season anything? So all of my food is bright red because that's what I grew up on. You know, it was a competition in my house who could eat the spiciest food. And
yeah,
I would never win because I was the youngest, but eventually we got there.
So I didn't tell you or your team this before, but I'm going to give it a shot. Every single person so far, I've asked them to take on board one person, even if it's for a week or 2 weeks, to shadow, gain an insight. Would you be willing to
100%.
Do that? I'm happy to screen the people and send you the top five.
Sure.
You're up for that.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah, 100%.
Yes.
That'll be an interesting experience for them.
Thank you.
That's dope. I love that. That's dope.
But yeah, no, thanks. It's been so insightful. And I think for me, we've spoken about things that I haven't seen out there. So thank you for coming.
Oh, thank you. It's an honour to be here. And I've loved your line of questioning. You're really good at this, you know?
Oh, am I?
Yeah, you're really good at this.
Cheers.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of the best interviews I've had in a long time.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
Did you hear that, right?
Interesting questions, unconventional. Yeah.